Like Sarah, I'm going to put my three big conclusions up at the beginning, especially as some of you may be flagging by now. And I'm also very aware, for those of you that weren't at the Brussels conference, I was put on at the end of a group of amazing speakers, and the same thing has happened to me tonight. And so hopefully what I'll try to do is, as well as introduce the advocacy guide to you, pull together one or two of the themes we've heard through the evening as well, because it's been so rich and so many profound lessons in there, I think, for what we can do and how we can take things forward. So I'm going to look at the Kicker Practical Guide on Advocacy. And why am I doing that? Well, advocacy is central to ensuring access to cochlear implants and provision of ongoing services. And the guide is just one of the things that we're trying to do at Kicker to actually help pull that together and provide that as support for people. Next slide, please. But I do want to put that in a bit of a context and just pull out slightly and look at this in the broader Kicker context, in that one of the sort of drivers for the founding of Kicker was the awareness of a whole number of us working in the health sector. There's been massive growth in global networks to address high-cost health issues. And we've seen that across tobacco, alcohol, maternal mortality, and a lot of other areas. And yet there wasn't a very specific global network to address the high cost of severe hearing loss and specifically access to cochlear implants. And that's not to again say any of the amazing work that's been done by WHO globally and many organizations across Europe, across other areas of the world. But there did, I think, to many of us, seem a gap in terms of bringing all those networks together and giving them something of that unified voice that Sarah was talking about earlier, in terms of what's so crucial about advocacy is speaking with one voice and then recognizing local and regional variations. And why is that? Well, we know that hearing loss is not seen as damaging to health and therefore given less priority. And specifically, that there's a lack of awareness in cochlear implants and its benefits and misconceptions about its cost effectiveness. Yes, on the other side, we also know that current advances in access to cochlear implants and support services have generally only happened because of the energetic and persistent advocacy and campaigning of user groups and individuals. And that, I think, is recognized very much in the World Report on Hearing, where it notes as well that advocacy can be effective drivers for policy formation, and that that has to be undertaken at a global, regional, and national levels to be effective. And that, in one sense, was one of the main drivers for the establishment of Kicker as a network. When we established Kicker, went out and talked to many advocates, professionals, the groups that were running many of those successful campaigns already, and asked them how important advocacy was. And it showed very high levels. I'm not going to go through all the figures, you can read them on the screen, but it showed very high levels of activity globally across the world. And that people also fed back to us, they wanted to be united by a common mission and goals to maximize the access to and support for implantation. Next slide, please. And when we looked at the data in that report, there was a very strong belief in the value of advocacy and the strengths in promoting grassroots advocacy of service users. But there was also a fundamental recognition that this puts a massive, massive strain and responsibility on the users of those services, on people with cochlear implants, on their families, to both acquire advocacy skills, to acquire expertise, to find the evidence and resources and train themselves. And it's great that we have the recognition that there should be nothing without the engagement of users and their families. But at the same time, those users and families don't automatically, because they're a user of implant services, start off as an advocate with all the expertise and skills necessary to do that. And one of the big pulls within that research was for more support for more support to bring that network together, to give it the skills and tools it needed, to give it both the evidence to be able to harness that passion. And I love the concept of passion with progress that Sara introduced earlier. And in a way, that very much, I think, sums up what Kicker is trying to do. And if you want to know more, read more about the nuance of those responses and how we set that within an international context, do go and have a look at the article in the International Journal of Audiology. One of the key things that we were asked for out of that consultation was more support to increase advocacy expertise. And that's why Kicker has produced the Practical Guide to Advocacy. Next slide, please. And I just want to now, in the second half of my talk, having kind of put the guide in context, just say a little bit more about why it is the way it is and some of the key themes to come out of it. And I think as many of the speakers have reflected through the evening, and this was both in Carolina's and in Sara's presentations and in those of the advocates doing the campaigns on the ground, however good the evidence is that people need cochlear implants, however good the need is demonstrated that people need those, nothing happens until you create awareness of that need. There is no such thing as a social problem until enough people with enough power in society agree there is. So the idea that on its own, more cochlear implants will be provided for those that need it, that more hearing services will be provided for those that need it, just isn't so. We need to create that frame of there being an issue here that we need to address. And that issue is the lack of provision for cochlear implants and the need for ongoing lifelong services to support those with cochlear implants. And within that, we do think that one of the most valuable tools that individual advocates have is their own stories. But as Sara said earlier, those stories then need to be set in a context where there's the evidence, where there's the strategy to actually realize that. And that is essentially what the guide is trying to help people to do, based very much on the amazing work that's already being done across the world that Kicker as a network can tap into and actually be able to then demonstrate and share so that other people can learn from each other what has really worked for them in different contexts. Next slide, please. So the guide itself, and I can only give you just a kind of hint of what's in there in the time I've got, starts off with the case I've just been making really about why advocacy for CIs is so important, why they won't just be expanded on their own and neither will services be expanded on their own, that we need the vibrant advocacy and passion of those that are users, those want cochlear implants and their families and the professionals that support them to be able to do that. We then had a real kind of challenge. There's lots of good guides on advocacy out there. There's already lots of material out there. So what were we trying to do with this? Essentially, pull together the knowledge and expertise that was already there in the network and ally that with the professional expertise we have both in Kicker and again across a lot of the network and through professionals, through the WHO, to actually then exemplify what has worked. And so the second part of the report is a whole number of case studies where successfully people have already advocated for improvements one way or another in relation to implant and implant services. And then what we've done in the third part is to actually put together some tools that build very much on some of the things that Sara in her talk was talking about what good advocacy looks like, what tools you can have to actually do that. And then lastly, what resources are already available to make that happen. And the idea around the guide is also, this is something that will grow over time. We could not encapsulate all of this within the 20 pages that it currently has. What we have got in there are multiple links, both to other case studies, to resources, and also to advocacy tools. Next slide, please. Just to give you some sense of the case studies, there indeed is Eddie, who you heard about earlier, with his daughter, and that's one of the case studies in there. So we have a whole number of case studies addressing different bits of a potential global strategy and also local strategy to improve cochlear implants, taking particular issues such as addressing low referrals for CI, reducing the potential costs for CI, and a whole number of others that start from that crucial thing that Sarah talked about. You know, what is the problem that you're actually trying to address? What is the solution you're proposing to that problem? Then we looked at what the group actually did and then what the outcome was. And hopefully that can give people a framework of thinking and working within. And when there's particular campaign tools they've used, there's links to that, and there's further links to those people often talking about what they were doing. Next slide, please. If you look at the advocacy tools, I've just thrown one up here again because it's illustrative of, well, how do you define what that problem is? Here is a tool in the problem tree that does that. There are a whole number of other tools there that people can use in their own practice to get some kind of rigor and method into what they're doing in the way that Sarah and Carolina both emphasized earlier is really important if you're going to be successful. Next slide, please. And in the third section there, you can see some of the resources, some of the resources that are available, including multiple ones from WHO. And I really would encourage people to go and look at those. They're a fantastic basis for your advocacy in your own countries. And as Sarah was talking about, the crucial importance of having that consistent global message and then making it local in terms of what works in your area. And the WHO materials especially give us that consistent global message, and then it's how we can adjust those with individual areas. But there's also some other great stuff around, and some of that is also mentioned there. We will be doing more on doing that. And that fits within a kicker context. Next slide, please, where we refer a lot to some of the other briefing support and evidence that we have produced, because that was the other crucial thing that the network said it really wanted in terms of where is the evidence. How can we present that in clear ways for advocates? So there is an amazing amount of brilliant evidence across the whole sector, but not all advocates have the time to read it all. And therefore, one of our other core aims was to reduce a lot of that brilliant evidence to small bite-sized reports, documents, where people could pull the crucial things they needed for advocacy out of that and make it work for them locally. And so I think Sue put in the chat earlier that we've done briefings around the World Hearing Report. We've done briefings around the Living Standards Guidelines, working with families, and now the Cochlear Implant Services Matter Report and the Young People's Report. So hopefully the guide fits together with all these resources that you need to be successful advocates. Next slide, please. So what do we do now? Policy gets changed because of convincing narratives, not just good evidence. It's how we put all that together and then put it out to the world in a way where people can kind of really understand the problem and relate to the problem as well as just the evidence. And we're working further on how we can produce some of those convincing narratives that people can then use, with a focus on person-centered lifelong services and continuing to develop the research on the real-life impact of hearing loss and deafness, and then provide support for individual groups and active engagement with users and families and professionals in improving access and provision. And this guide is one tool to be able to do that. In terms of developing the guide, we want, as the next steps, to do a whole number of video case studies with you that really start to exemplify some of those stories and voice around all of that. And we'll also be running some more workshops with you. So please download it, please use it, please come back and tell us how you're using it. And hopefully together we will be able to make some of the changes that we want.